This is part 16 of square roots and radicals, and in this video we're going to start by doing some more examples rationalizing the denominator. So far we've only done this with square roots. Alright, so let's look at this problem, square root of 5/3. What you could do is say, well, that's the square root of the numerator over the square root of the denominator. And since the denominator is irrational because there's the square root, remember you do this little trick of multiplying the numerator and denominator by square root of 3. The idea is to get the denominator to not have a square root. And so square root of 3 times square root of 3 is just 3. It's now a rational number. So in the numerator, we have square root of 5 times square root of 3, which is square root of 15. Okay, because the rule for multiplying when they're both under the square root is to multiply the two numbers together. So that's the answer. You cannot cancel that 3 into the 15. Remember that 3 is a whole number, where 15 is not a whole number. That's underneath the square root sign. It's very different. Now here's another way of doing the same problem. You could just sort of extend your square root and underneath the square root multiply the top and bottom by 3, so that you'll have a perfect square in the denominator because you've got two 3s in the denominator now. That's just a little bit of a shortcut if you like that method. So now you could break the numerator and denominator up. In the numerator, you'd have the square root of 15 over the square root of 3 times 3 will simply be 3. All right, let's try another example. All right, square root of 5/12. There are a few ways you could do this problem. One way is to simplify the numerator and denominator by first just writing the square root of the numerator over the denominator. But the square root of 12 is not simplified because 12 is 4 times 3. So I'm going to do a little shortcut method. We know that 12 is 4 times 3, right? So the square root of 4 is 2. That tells you you could take a 2 out of the square root, and so you'd have 2 square roots of 3. Or you could do this on scratch paper. Then you have a square root of 3 in the denominator. 2 is already rational. You don't need to multiply it by a 2, but you do need to multiply it by the square root of 3. Okay, so what do I have in the numerator? Square root of 5 times square root of 3 is square root of 15. And in the bottom, what do I have? I've got 2 times 3, right? So I have 2 times 3, which is 6. So for this problem, that's one way of getting the correct answer. Okay, look at it slightly differently. Let's say I want to keep everything as is. I think, well, what can I multiply the numerator and denominator by to get a perfect square in the denominator? Okay, so if you realize that you only have to multiply the bottom by 3 to get square root of 36, you could simply multiply the top and bottom by 3 this way. So then that gives you square root of 15 over square root of 36, right? Which is square root of 15 over 6. See, you have some options. It sort of depends on how you look at it. When you look at a problem, what seems more natural? A common mistake is for people to write the way I did it this top way, to multiply the top and bottom by 2 square roots of 3. And that's okay, but you're just going to have to, again, at the next step, divide out that extra 2. Let's do this one more time, the square root of 5 over square root of 12. This is how a lot of people will do it. They'll first write it as square root of 5 over square root of 12, and then just multiply by the square root of 12 over square root of 12. This is okay, but you're multiplying it by a bigger number than you really need to. So instead of actually multiplying 5 times 12, I'm going to write it in a factored form, the way I've done in a lot of problems. I've got the 5, and I'm going to note there's 4 as a perfect square in there. That's 4 times 3. Now on the bottom, I just get 12, right? Because square root of 12 times square root of 12 is 12. Okay, so you with me so far? I could have written 60 instead of 5 times 4 times 3, but I wrote it this way so that we could see that I'm going to take that 4 out. I mean, I'm going to take the square root of 4 out as a 2. So I'll have a 2 square roots of 15 over 12. But now you can cancel the 2 and the 12 because both of those are outside the square roots. Right? And you see how your final answer will still look like square root of 15 over 6, or how I wrote it over here. Square root of 15 over 6. So you could just go ahead and crunch it out. If you got a square root of 12, multiply by square root of 12 over square root of 12. It means you'll have to cancel in the end if there was a smaller square root you could have multiplied. For instance, square root of 3 is all you really needed to multiply by. Here's one for you to try. The square root of 7/8. You want to write this so that there are no irrational numbers in the denominator. Okay, again, there are a couple ways to do this. You could just write square root of 7 over square root of 8. Multiply the top and bottom by square root of 8. And if you didn't even want to think about anything, you can go ahead and just write square root of 56 over 8. But it's not simplified because there's a perfect square in the square root of 56. 4 is the perfect square in that. All right? So if you would have left this 7 times 8 in factored form, you probably would have seen that. But that's, you're going to have to finish by writing that as 4 times 14 underneath the square root. Take out the 2. And then cancel. This is kind of the long way to get it. But it's the way a lot of students do it because they don't want to think ahead. All right, so here's another way of doing it. 7/8. I'm going to think, is there something I can multiply the denominator by to get a perfect square? And actually, 2 works because I'll get the square root of 16. So if you see that, then in the numerator you're going to have square root of 14, and the denominator you've got the square root of 16, which is 4. A little bit faster. And then you could also do this by putting the square root of 7 over the square root of 8, but simplifying the denominator first, instead of multiplying by square root of 8. So if you simplify the square root of 8, remember 8 is 4 times 2, so from the square root of 4, 2 gets out. And then you could just multiply the numerator and denominator by square roots of 2. So what do I have here? Square root of 7 times square root of 2 is square root of 14. And in the bottom, I have 2 times 2, right? Because square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2, so I end up with 2 times 2, which is just 4. So, 3 ways doing the same problem. Let's do another problem. Square root of 2 over 45. So, again, you could simplify, I'm sorry, you could take the square root of the numerator over the square root of the denominator. I'm going to write the denominator factored. This might help you see what you really need. So if I write the denominator in factored form, I have, or as a perfect square times something, I have 9 times 5, right? I could see that 9's a perfect square, but I also need to have a factor of 5 down there to also take the 5 out. So if you're not sure what you can multiply 45 times to get a perfect square, you can write the factored form as one perfect square, and you'll see the leftover amount that's necessary. So now I have in the numerator, square root of 2 times 5 is square root of 10. And in the denominator, all right, what do I have here? I've got the square root of 9. That's going to be 3, right? And from both those 5s, I get a 5 out. So I'm going to be able to multiply a 3 times 5. So that's going to be 15. Sort of a shortcut way of doing that. You could also first simplify the square root of 45, which is 3 square roots of 5, and then multiply the numerator and denominator by square root of 5. And you'll get exactly the same answer, square root of 10 over 15. So make sure you do it in a way that makes most sense to you. If you like to separate the numerator and denominator out and simplify it, that might be easier than the way I did it at the top here. All right, we're going to go on to some more problems like this in the next video, where we're working with higher roots, and then we'll do rationalizing the denominator when we don't have just a simple square root in the denominator.